Today, we focus on startup ecosystem, how business opportunity can be created with innovative marketing strategy. I can't wait to find out from our speakers. So now let me introduce our moderator for this panel discussion. Our moderator, he is a popular writer. He was also a TV show host, and now he's the founder of Dream School and startup Latte. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our moderator, Mr. Tom Wang. And now let me invite our panelists to the stage. Mr. Han Stone, managing partner of GGV. Okay, I was told that he might not be able to make it. All right, so is Mr. Raine Ma here with us?
Yes.
All right, so our panelists, Mr. Raine Ma, investment partner and head of fundraising of 500 startups. And next panelist, Mr. Lucas Wong, CEO of HW Track. Please welcome Mr. Wong. And now I invite Mr. Emmerich Renner, director of Sandus Venture. Mr. Renner, welcome. Last but not least, Miss Angel Garcia, co-founder and CEO of Startup Bootcamp. Mister. Welcome. All right, here's the time for our moderator and prominent speakers.
Great, thank you, Ms. Joe. Good morning, everybody. This is the all-star panel. We only have 1 hour, so let's just get right into it. We all know your names and titles now, but we don't actually know what you do. So why don't we just go around and have everybody talk about what you're doing now? Why don't we start with you, Ma?
Sure. Hi, everyone. My name is Ray. I work with 500 Startups. We're a Silicon Valley-based global accelerator program and seed fund. We were started about 6 years ago, and we have invested in 1,500 companies in 60 different countries. One of those includes Taiwan. We've invested in about 12, I think, here in Taiwan. And we actually have 8 more companies from outside of Taiwan that we invested in that we brought to Taiwan. So they now have subsidiaries in Taiwan. I myself have been coming regularly here for the past 4 years. And I'm lucky enough to have 3 other colleagues. I don't think they're here yet because they thought I was going to be in the next panel. But I have 3 other colleagues here in Taipei. And as the host said, I'm in charge of sort of Greater China as well as fundraising for the fund. And I spend now half of my time in Silicon Valley.
Thank you, Ray. And special thanks to Ray. She was scheduled for the 10:30 session, but because Hans didn't make his flight, so Ray was graceful enough to agree to come early. Thank you, Ray. And thank you for also investing in 12 companies in Taiwan. There are a few startup teams down there, so make sure you get her car before you go. Thank you, Ray. And Lucas, thank you.
Hi, everyone. Morning. I'm Lucas. I'm the CEO of Hardware Track, HW Track also. And this is the platform we built. It's called for the Hardware Innovation Global Platform. What we do is we help the innovators from worldwide to connect with the supply chain resources, especially from Asia, and help them to build their dreams. We started around 2014, and then now we have around 1,800 projects on the platform, and then we help them to bridge to the various kind of the suppliers, so starting from the chipset level and all the way to the big names like ODM names here, tier ones. Also, now we kind of extended to a little bit service to the retail. So since we started in 2014, we are very glad to know how the dynamic of the supply chain innovations around the world. So this is a very good experience we can share, and I hope that everybody can love that.
Thank you. Well, 2 years, but 1,800 projects already. I'm curious, where are these creators? In Taiwan or internationally?
Yeah, this is a good question. Sorry, I missed that. Right now, among 90% of them are coming from US and Europe.
Wow. Yeah. So it's a truly global platform.
Yes.
Terrific. But we still want our local audience to take advantage of that platform. It's called Hardware Tracks. You can look it up when you listen to Lucas to speak. Emmerich, please.
Thanks. Ni hao. It's my first time in Taiwan, so I'm super excited to be here. Thanks for having me. I'm with SanDisk Corporation on the venture capital side. So some of you may know SanDisk. We're a semiconductor company making NAND flash, so the type of memory systems you'll find in SD cards, micro SD cards, in things like cell phones and tablets. But we go way beyond that. If you think about where flash is located, we're in gaming consoles, we're in media set-top boxes, we're behind a dash in a Tesla, you're seeing flash in drones, in nanosatellites, in the data center. So at SanDisk, we're interested in all those aspects of it and funding any innovation that relates to storage, whether it be consuming lots of it, whether it can be things like even software that can benefit from flash storage, say in-memory databases, software-defined storage, or things that will generate lots of content to fill storage. So that's where especially some of the innovations in this hall come into play. Things around drones, of course, but also things around AR, VR, as you start doing having more camera setups, you know, surround video, panoramic photography, stereoscopic, all these things consume lots of data. We're also interested in sensors, better CCDs, better zoom lenses, stuff around computational photography, light field imaging. We're a multi-stage investor. We can start as early as Series A, and we can do very large checks later on, $20 million, even if we have to, in later stage rounds. And the most recent announcement on our side, at the corporate levels, we're now part in Western Digital, one of the premier hard drive companies. So the powerhouse of Western Digital and SanDisk together, we've really created a global storage company, and we're interested in all those aspects that tie into it. So you'll see us doing more investments worldwide. We've only been investing so far for about 3 years, mostly North America, Europe, and Middle East, but we've already had a number of exits. So Cisco acquired one of our companies 2 years ago. Last year, the Oculus division of Facebook bought one of our companies around virtual reality. Earlier this year, we sold a company to Oracle, and we sold one to Sony. We had a company called Altair Communications doing LTE chipsets. So you'll see us very active across components, systems, and software, and even services.
Wow, the topic of this session is the next big thing. Sounds like you are doing all the next big things already. It's the first time in Taiwan.
Yes.
How do you like it so far?
It's fantastic.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you like the weather yesterday?
Honestly, it doesn't bother me. I mean, I lived in Brazil as a kid, which is fairly warm and humid, you know, also in the 30s Celsius. I spent time in college in Singapore, which is also quite warm and humid. So, yeah, this kind of climate doesn't bother me.
Great.
But I like the energy. It's fun being here.
Okay. Well, the weather here is as hot as a startup world, so experience it. Okay, our last guest, Angel, welcome to Taiwan.
Thank you, Betty. Really glad to be here today and see all the energy, all the people here. So I'm from a Startup Bootcamp. A Startup Bootcamp is a global network of startup accelerators. We started like 6 years ago. And today we have, I think it's 13 programs in different cities all around the world. We have programs in London, Berlin, Amsterdam, Barcelona, New York, Miami, Singapore in Asia, and hopefully soon in Taipei. And the way that we do that, every city, every program focus in a specific industry, in a specific vertical. In London, we are doing fintech, in Miami, digital health, and trying to attract the best startups from all around the world to this specific city to create an ecosystem around this specific program, right? We also have great major corporate partners supporting our programs like Intel or Cisco or Bosch, big companies that they see cooperation with the Startup Bootcamp in order to have access to this innovation coming from the startups. So this is basically what we are doing.
So you guys are in 13 locations. How many startups have you accelerated?
I think because this is changing every day, I think right now we are in the 320, something like that.
Wow.
We are not, I mean, every year, every program, we just accelerate 10 startups. I mean, we don't want to do this 50 or 60 one year in one city because we really want to devote enough attention, enough to take care about just a minimum number of startups in order to really be able to accelerate it.
I see. And I understand many of them went out and received funding, right?
I think there are some statistics that are in the website that are public. I think that the average is 75% of the startups that are joining our programs, they raise money in an average of €500,000. We are targeting early startups. But I think that more than that, I think the best statistic that we have is that 84% of the startups that have gone through our program, they are still alive. Mm-hmm. And after 6 years, I think I'm talking about the startups mortality, I think it's a very relevant number.
Great, terrific. So now you all know our four panelists, and I think I would like them to know a little about you so they can tailor their messages to you. Emery, you had an idea about polling the audience. You want to do that?
Yeah.
Why don't you do that?
Yeah.
Sure. I'm kind of curious. Who in the audience here is currently in a startup?
现在在创业的，有没有？ How many of you are starting up a company now? Only one team?
Oh, wow.
Okay.
and who here is within a larger kind of like a corporate player in the ecosystem that may be exhibiting a Computex or is in the IT industry broadly?
中型公司或大一点公司的举手有吗？ Anybody works for a big company? So okay. Who are you?
Anybody else thinking of doing a startup? Wondering, debating?
有没有人现在想要创业的呢? 考虑, you're thinking about starting up a company? Oh, great. Thank you very much. I understand this is an international audience. Who is not from Taiwan? Okay, let me see. Where are you from? Where are you from, gentlemen? Will you please stand up? Where are you from? Germany.
Yeah.
Wow. First time to Taiwan too?
Yeah.
What kind of company are you working for?
Like the medical group of Foxconn.
Uh-huh. Oh, Foxconn.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Who else is not from Taiwan? Oh, thank you for coming.
I'm from Holland, the Netherlands.
Oh, Holland. And are you working for a startup or a big company?
Development company. Yeah. Oh, product development.
Terrific, terrific. Thank you. So this is a truly international audience. Many are in startup world, but many are not. So let's just keep that in mind and share our views on the next big thing. So as you know, the topic is the next big thing. So why don't I just ask each of you to share your views on the next big thing, and we will go from there. And I really want you guys to have a chance to talk to them. So during the session, if you have any question or if you have anything to add, don't hesitate. We don't have too much time, so let's take advantage of it. Ray, would you like to start? In your view, what's the next big thing or things?
In my view or in my fund's view or in other investors' views? Well, I think, if it wasn't clear earlier, like actually me and Angel, I think we, our funds operate at the similar stage, right? So pre-series A. So we see a lot of, you know, ideas maybe that are a little bit out there. I don't know if they're going to be the next big thing, but they are not, hopefully they're something that are a little bit more disruptive than what's, you know, in the late stages now. So I think for us, we are actually not necessarily looking for the next big thing. So we've actually made limited investments in things that are very hot right now, like AI, like VR, right, like robotics, because we actually do tend to go for products that already have a prototype and some customer traction and revenue, which by definition can exclude some of these really, really new industries where there are not an existing base of customers, right? So that being said, we're trying to allocate between 5 to 10% of the spaces in our accelerator program for things that we think are very disruptive. So a lot of things we've talked about are like space. So we have a lot of space nerds in the office. However, we have yet to figure out exactly what we can do with that. We've actually invested in a few genomics startups. So companies that are they're trying to analyze parts of, you know, the human genome. Or we invested in one called UBiome, which analyzes, you know, the your individual biome, and right now it's just analytics, but ideally in the future it can be used towards helping you stay healthier, right? I think those are things we're highly interested in, and I definitely think they're going to be the next big thing, but I don't have too many, I guess, specific examples of portfolio companies that are doing that. In the last batch of Accelerator companies that we just graduated just 2 weeks ago, I noticed that we had three or four AI companies. But I think AI is an underlying technology. It's not, you know, I think right now it's sexy to say, oh, I'm an AI startup. But in reality, I think AI will be incorporated into basically everything, right? So specifically, some of the use cases we invested in, for example, a company that helps you make your own chatbot, right? So help you create, you know, a bot that can intelligently interact with your customers. We also invested in something that I think many people here might find helpful. If English is not your first language, you know, it's a program that's that modifies your non-English speaking writing into something that is much more colloquial for, you know, business and professional use. So I think those types of companies are going to become underlying technologies, they're using underlying technologies that are going to be useful for many, many industries. And while the use case they have right now are relatively narrow, hopefully the technology they develop as they're trying to scale up, they can find more and more customers. And then I think, I don't want to take away from everyone else's topics, but we've also invested in a few VR companies right now, specifically focusing on content and content production. I know that's very hot in Asia. I just came from another two conferences in southern China and Hong Kong, where I think, like, I don't know, every investor was asking about companies in this space.
Great, terrific. So three categories. One is AR, VR, especially on the content side. The second is AI, and the third is bio/medical. You guys want to add anything in these three categories before you share your view? Just to echo.
Yeah, sure. I mean, one aspect which is always interesting are the cycles of technology, because some of the things we've talked about here, you know, you look at AI, that's been around for quite some time in different areas, right? You look at people now talking about all the different kind of artificial intelligence assistants. Those were called it used to be IA, intelligent assistants, back in the days of General Magic, which is an Apple spinoff, or even Apple's Newton project. Or you look at the Knowledge Navigator concept videos from the early 90s. They basically had a combination of a wireless device, a World Wide Web, and an intelligent assistant responding to verbal queries of, like, show me information about this, include this in my document. So it was a combination of Clippy meets something like Siri meets other technologies, and now we can just do that extremely efficiently because we have the World Wide Web, we have fast networks, all the kind of elements are coming finally into place where that vision can happen. But people have tried this kind of stuff in the past. Same thing with Apple data detectors, writing, you know, I have lunch with Lucas next Tuesday. It knows intelligently what next Tuesday is. Lunch, it assumes noon. It'll find Lucas in my contact book, create an entry, right? That's early artificial intelligence or intelligent assistant. Except now we can do that again more efficiently. And same thing with some of the areas around VR. It was QuickTime VR. It was VRML, virtual reality markup language for the World Wide Web, for those of you who remember that, in kind of the mid-late 90s. But the technology was really early, clunky. We didn't have the processing capabilities, the resolution. All that stuff is coming into fruition now. And as we progress, I think this year probably won't be it for VR because you don't have the mass market yet. It's really kind of early adopter. But in the next, like, 2, 3, 4 years, people will understand the medium, understand how to make content, and we're going to see the prices for these devices plummet. And that'll be really, really interesting at that point in terms of, like, the startup potential around those technology areas.
Thank you, Emery, for elaborating on that. Lucas, your take on the next big thing.
This is to us, because we slightly changed our focus a little bit, tried to focus on the supply chain. And so what we have seen right now is a new thing. It's not actually new. It's something like people needed. Right now we have very good turn of that. It's called supply chain service 4.0. It's a little bit cliche. But let me elaborate that a little bit. Supply chain service 4.0, what's that mean? It's brought by the some kind of German consulting firm. He thinks that people need some kind of digital strategy to make supply chain companies a little bit open, a little bit collaborative, and then a little bit communicator enabled, which means that they want to make sure that although we have, like put this way, right now the world of the innovations is very fast, right? People want rapid manufacture, prototyping. People have the ideas every day, and then they want to build it. They want to realize that. So this world is moving so fast. So the other side of the supply chain world, now people are talking about so-called Industry 4.0, right? How to make your supply chain automatic, how to make your factory smart, how to make your inventory visible, predictable, something like this. But think about that. These two worlds are not connected to each other yet. Okay? This side moves very fast. This side try to catch up. But the problem is, where's the conversion of the information and data? The demand and the innovators, they request for the memories or something. But of course, like from the syntax, they can support the memories. But what happens after I get a very good support from SanDisk? I need to find someone who build me the whole stuff, right? The other display, screen, sensor. So where can I go? So the two worlds right now are like super standalone to each other. Like they're not talking to each other so much. And it's only through the traditional way, like trade show, people talk to each other by email still, exchange the data by Excel, and then follow on the task list by probably again by Excel. So this is the way that how these two worlds communicate each other now. But in the future, since that we had a very good digitized here from the innovation part, and then also we have very good digitized from the Industrial 4.0, so then we try to think about how we can connect this two digitized world now. So now people are talking about the supply chain service 4.0. So we have to emphasize one thing, one turn is the service. So supply chain, the factory, or the technology, we are not just selling technology now, we are actually offering the service. Because the customer is changing, right? We used to like the ODM, also from the ODM. We used to serve Nokia, Lucent, and from Telecom. So we know what they are talking about. They know what we are talking about. And then we know each other's schedule. So there's no gap between the communications. So we're moving fast in the synchronized speed. But today, some startups, like 500 startups invest in the Silicon Valley. They're probably not good at the hardware. They're very good at software, very good at service. They can build fantastic apps. And now they need some kind of small gadgets to extend their service. So what happened then? So they go to Foxconn? I don't think so. They need to build their own supply chain virtually. They need to source something. They need to find a good service. So that's part of the reason why Shenzhen is so popular right now. They call the Silicon World, this is a new term from Wired. That's the Silicon Valley of manufacture or Silicon Valley of the hardware. So that's the reason why people want to go there and have those service be served in one place. But this is the physical world. So Shenzhen represent a very good physical world of innovation of the hardware. Right now, they position that, and they are doing very good at that. But now what happened is, can we put all those kind of things online? Why? People are always going online to manage themselves, manage the activities right now. So can we perceive that in the future, the supply chain service could be offered to you virtually, online, with internet speed? And then people can connect, communicate each other real time. So this is what we're seeing. It's a new change coming called the supply chain service 4.0, which again, try to bridge the two worlds right now.
So the keywords are supply chain service 4.0. It's a new kind of supply chain service. On one hand, you have these hardware creators or entrepreneurs. On the other, you have all these companies that provide supply chain services. And we need somebody or some platform to connect the two. Actually, hardware tracks is play this bridge right now. So supply chain service is very important for hardware entrepreneurs. So I'm wondering what's hot in the hardware maker world right now?
Yeah. I will start just briefly because our platform is a little bit like early stage startups right now, most of them. So for example, like a VR, AR, actually we saw those kind of projects in 2014 mostly, the glasses.
Okay.
So right now what people are seeing right now on site, probably on our platform, that will be like in 2014, that is the hottest topic, one of them.
Good.
But this year, we see lots of the peripheral of the VR, AR.
Oh, peripherals. So
it's not just glasses anymore. Now people are thinking about, what if I got the glasses? What if 10% of you now have the glasses? So what happened now? It's how you interact. So now people are on the platform, we can see lots of the innovative projects, like how they build this small peripheral that can interact when you are in the VR world or in the AR world. So this is one of the biggest trends. The other thing is, I hate to say this, but it's robotic things. It's not robotic things. So it's something like I would describe a little bit like in the general terms, that people starting to use mechanical parts, physical parts, to service some, to provide some service. One example, which I love this kind of idea, is like a small vending machine of pills, to remind the elder to take the pills, to take what kind of pills. This is a very old topic, right? Just for example, this is a very old topic, lots of people want to solve that. They give the elder the wearable, the vest, or some kind of BB buzz device to make sure that you have to take the medicine, take the pills for your diabetes things to control that. But now people have this kind of devices built, it's a little bit like a mechanical vending machine. So in the morning, assume that your grandma needs to like three kind of pills, not including the diabetes one. She needs to take the higher pressure, blood pressure pill in the morning. So they will drop the pills, and then sent out, and then like a vending machines, and beep beep, make the sound or something. So my grandma will see this and say, okay, I have to take the pills, but I don't need to think what kind of pills I need to take. I just take it. So most of the elders that have some kind of problem is, did I take it or not? Most of the time, people will get this kind of confused. So these kind of small machines, and then among lots of them, are trying to solve this kind of problem right now using a little bit sophisticated mechanical design. So very good.
Good. Okay, so you echo Ray and talk about AR, but especially on the peripheral side. Peripheral是这个周边设备的意思啊。 And you also brought up robotics. That's a quite interesting mechanism, a pill dispenser, if you will. 就是帮助老人家吃药的。 一些自动化的设备. Very interesting.
And maybe, if I can jump in a little bit on that area in terms of hardware, one of the interesting trends right now is connected devices, you know, home IoT, et cetera, but to have layers of intelligence and additional services on top of it. So we're investors, for instance, in a company called August, which makes a variety of smart lock related products. And there you can think, okay, it's one thing to make a mechanical lock that you can unlock with a cell phone, but really, the interesting aspect of it is what they've done with the layers on top of it, with a connectivity layer API. So that now, for instance, for those of you familiar with Airbnb and other sort of vacation rent and home rental services, one of the big problems with that is key exchange. If you have something like an August smart lock, when you're making the reservation, you can get a virtual electronic key that's available so you don't have to worry about hunting down the owner or concierge, someone else to do the key exchange, and you can only get in and out of the house during the duration of your stay. Similarly, you know, people have been doing webcams that detect motions and motion alerts for a while, but what's more interesting is where companies, and we're not investors in that one, but it's a really cool company out of France called NetAtmo that has a security camera that does on-camera image recognition and processing. Because I don't need to know if there's motion necessarily, but it's important for me to know who came in. Do I recognize that person or not and get alert? Okay, so let's say it's a relative of mine. Maybe I want to be alerted when they're showing up inside the house, but I don't need the recording. If someone like the house cleaners, I probably want a recording and see what they're doing. If someone I don't know, then I definitely want an alert. And they're doing similar things with outdoor cameras. I can say, hey, there's someone walking towards your front door, or a car that's not yours just parked in your driveway. Those are kind of like additional insights that really bring value to that product beyond it. So look, tying in the intelligence, the computing capabilities, and the software layers are really important. It's not enough just to have a connected object. It's really what you do with it and how you bring value.
Can we call this category smart home, smart appliances?
Yeah, and extra smart, right? Because I think the first attempt at smart products were really just kind of connected products. Mm-hmm. But these are truly, you're starting to see things that emerge that have more thought put into it, more intelligence, and more data.
Mm-hmm. Terrific. Thank you, Emery. Angel, what's your view on the next big thing?
Well, being the last one is difficult, but I will try to make a different approach to these kind of things, because probably, well, we have said AI, virtual reality, I think those kind of words are maybe important for the people inside this building, but I think it's not so important for people outside of this building, right? And when I try to see about the future, innovation, or the next big thing, I try to avoid thinking about these kind of technologies. I try to think about how people is gonna live in 5 years from now, how this is gonna change our life. Are we gonna use coins? Are we gonna travel in a different way? Are we gonna have a car? Someone told me 6 months ago that my daughter, that now is 6 years old, will not have a driver license. I mean, these kind of things about, I think it's the best way to think about the next big thing, or the next thing, is about thinking how people is gonna live in 5-10 years from now. I remember 5 years ago, we were talking about smart homes, everything is gonna be connected, it's gonna be the refrigerator. Well, how many connected devices you have at home? I mean, sometimes we try to see the future, but I think the best way to do it is to try to understand how people is gonna live. Are we gonna have 3D printing for human organs? Is it gonna really change our lives? We are gonna have much more nanotechnology. Things that are gonna affect the way that we live. Because at the end, those kind of things, artificial intelligence, virtual reality, is just technologies that are gonna push us to really change the way that we live, or the way that we perform, right? It's my view of, as an investor too, trying to see what kind of things, what kind of behaviors, what kind of things people are gonna do, and what kind of things people are not gonna do. Because this is the final use of the technology is used by humans, by people. And if we are not changing the way that we do things, it's gonna be very difficult to have these technologies really being important in our life. And just try to provide a different approach to this.
Well, let's talk about that. How are we going to live in 5 years? Or how different are we going to live in 5 years?
Probably if I have the right answer, then I'm not gonna be here, right? I'm gonna be, it's difficult. I mean, I think that we are failing every 5 years, we are, to some extent, failing in the predictions, right? I was talking about the smart homes, everything is gonna be connected. It's not connected yet. IoT, 5 years ago, this is gonna be the next thing. Well, it's coming, but it's not here yet. Because changing human behavior is difficult. I mean, it's not easy. But technology, what I have to say is that we have to be happy to live in the times, right? Because things are changing so fast. Technology is changing a lot of things in a path that we cannot believe, even imagine 5 years ago. I remember two weeks ago in London, I was in my Uber with my driver. It was a guy from Africa or whatever. And the guy was so excited about the technology. I was an employee, and yes, with this Uber thing, I can have a work. Every morning I go, I rent my Toyota Prius, and then I earn £200 every year. So technology is amazing. I'm really happy about the technology. And I told him, have you heard about driverless cars? Because technology could also change. I mean, probably this guy, maybe in 10 years from now, is not gonna have a job because we are gonna have driverless car with our Uber account. So things are changing so fast that it's really, really difficult to predict. But I think the best way to look at that is looking about how people is gonna live, and what things we are gonna do, and probably what things we are not gonna do.
Yeah, that's keeping that in mind. Emery, please, go ahead.
Sure, yeah, and that's where there are some real opportunities for entrepreneurs, is to look at what the common threads are with some of these technologies. So in terms of driverless vehicles, when I went to school, when I started at Carnegie Mellon University in the US, Carnegie Mellon had a driverless vehicle that was driving around Pittsburgh. It was a really, really big van with a camper top extended, and you basically had a miniature data center in it. You had rack mount systems with Unix servers processing a ton of data, but you already had LiDAR, you already had cameras. It's just the technology at the time was like, you know, not as efficient. Nowadays, we can practically do some of those with cell phone class processors. So you look at the miniaturization, you look at the improvements around computer vision and things like that, and that really, there's some real opportunities there because computer vision affects, you know, driver assistance, not just driverless car, but even things that'll assist with like, you know, lane corrections and things like that. But it's also important for drones. It's increasingly important even potentially with rockets. You look at everything going on with like space 3.0 with companies like SpaceX and others, and some of the satellite companies in space doing sensor fusion. There's some really interesting things there that unify, that are involved in some of these companies. Same thing even computer vision, going back to security cameras and IoT. There's some real opportunities there to hit not just one industry, but multiple industries and have a really big big market there. Same thing with some of the communication processors, right? I mean, those areas are dominated by some big companies, but they're always next generation chipsets and next generation technologies. And another common thread with these things is gonna be communication protocols. We need faster, more reliable wireless access for data to connect all of these devices, whether it be rockets, intelligent sensors in a factory, elsewhere, in jet engines, in cars, in drones. All these things need to be hooked up reliably, and there's some real opportunities on that side as well.
Great. So you mentioned two common threats. One is communication protocol. The second is navigational software or something for the driverless car and the rocket.
Well, it could be aspects around navigation and things that tie into it, right? So to navigate, you need precise coordinates. So that means you need probably better technology than GPS. You need things that map out the environment and provide situational awareness. So that could be LiDAR systems, radar systems, computer vision to detect obstacles as well as potentially identify obstacles. Mm-hmm. All these things come into play and will be involved with cars, drones, and some of the space technologies as well.
Great. Common threats, these are very important words. If you can identify the common threats, you can see the next big thing. Ray, you want to add something? Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I wanted to add something like completely off topic of what we have been discussing so far, which is a lot of very concrete things. And one of the things, so I guess the opposite of how well people live might be what's wrong with, like, if you think there's something wrong with how the system is today. So one of our LPs and one of the smartest investors probably in the world, Fred Wilson at Union Square Ventures, one of their core theses and something that we've also tried to work on is right now, basically everything in consumer internet is based on sort of platform theory and network effects, right? So Facebook is powerful because we're all adding information to Facebook every day, especially in Taiwan, where I think the average length is like 5 times the worldwide average, right? Like every user is making Mark Zuckerberg richer, basically. But how are we benefiting from it other than, you know, being able to connect with our friends and getting funny articles and whatnot. So the flip side of that is if you believe this platform approach is it's unsustainable or not even necessarily healthy for society, then so that's a very highly centralized system. Then is it possible for us to live in a world where everything is decentralized? Of which, you know, I think the most successful, well, I don't know if you can argue it's successful yet, example would be the Bitcoin blockchain. But all blockchain technologies in general are meant to be much more decentralized in nature. So there are various experiments going on like that right now, but we've personally invested in quite a few blockchain-related companies, none of whom have gotten much traction yet, except maybe chain.com. But it is a very intriguing question. I think it's highly disruptive, right? So if we can figure out a way where me, Ray, I own all my data and all my transactions and my identity, and I want to interact with Tom, instead of going through a platform that captures most of the value of our transactions, can we just interact through a commonly agreed protocol, right? And then maybe the protocol, the creators of the protocol, does also take some value, but the the most of the value and most of the control over what's going on is still determined by, you know, me and you, right? So that could be on a consumer level or a business level. I actually think that's probably one of the most interesting ways I've heard of looking at the world and what might be coming in the, you know, next 5-10 years.
Well, interesting indeed. It is true that most Taiwanese people get most of their messages from platforms, especially Facebook. So you are seeing some kind of decentralization software?
Yeah, I mean, and I think in China, so not as much in, I think, the Western world, but in China, it's becoming increasingly obvious that you have these platforms and they do not want to work with each other, right? Mm-hmm. So if you're on, you know, Tencent's WeChat platform,
right,
you're like Taobao links, right, owned by Alibaba, literally do not open, mm-hmm. right? And it's because they have control over that. Mm-hmm. But how right. does that add value to me as a user? Like, that's actually detrimental to my experience.
Exactly.
Right? Uh-huh. So, but then I have no control because I have seeded all my data and, you know, everything basically to these platforms, right, who are basically doing whatever is best for the platform, not whatever is best for me. So a decentralized system,
right.
And many people are working on this. For example, a decentralized commerce system would be something like Open Bazaar. You guys can look it up. But that would give control back to the users versus right. Right. having a closed
right.
platform.
Right. I'm playing devil's advocate here. Could it be too late? Could we be sucked into platforms such as Facebook too deeply to be pulled back? I don't know. What do you guys think?
I definitely don't think so, but I think I gave my reason.
No, this is a very interesting topic. Well, that's okay. We don't have to solve the problem now. But I apologize for being not familiar with the company you just mentioned, chain.com, C-H-A-I-N.
Uh-huh. I don't think they have any consumer-facing products, but they're effectively developing blockchain technologies, mostly for financial institutions
okay.
right now. Yeah.
Great. Okay, blockchain technology or chain.com. Let's look them up after the session. Thank you. This is a very interesting topic. I want to invite you guys to say a few words or ask a few questions. We have about 20 minutes left, and we have friends from all over the world, and it's a real opportunity for all of us to get together. So why don't we open this to questions here? Okay, this gentleman here. Please use the microphone. Please tell us your name and the company you work for so our panel knows who you are.
Jackson Hu, W.I. Harper.
Thank you.
I have two questions for the panelists. Number one, what is the hit rate or success rate for these days startup? Question number two, what are the common attributes that you observe out of those successful entrepreneurs?
Okay, thank you. For your information, W. Harper is a world famous venture capital company. So two questions. Success rate, anybody want to take a shot at that? And Lucas, go ahead.
Yeah,
Angel.
I can start with that. Although our platform is not for like startups or VC things, our platform is to help those who want to create something and then actually they can build it. So currently on our platform, the hit rate, if that's the term to apply here, is by definition is those who want to build something and then finally they got the product shipped, the ratio is around 30-40%. The smart devices, IoT stuff on our platform. So that only represent like the worldwide the projects we have, not including the VC world. So this is only tell us like if you want to build something, and then now you can successfully get the money, people, resources, retail, and then blah 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 at the end, and then you can have your any kind of in creation to deliver to the consumer world. That's on our platform is 30% only. It's not high.
Even if you got all the resources. Actually, most yes, people don't get all those resources.
We still try to improve that. But the funny thing is, if you shift a little bit to the VC angle, among those successfully shipped projects, not all necessarily are VC backed. Some of them are from the SMBs, some of them from the startups that never take the money from the VC. And the interesting part is some of those guys took the money from the VC, but they never shipped. This is a very strange world right now. For example, Oculus Rift, right? The VR glasses, until today, they are still shipping the EVT DVT version, which is evaluation version. So it's almost like 6 years, something. They haven't shipped the real product to the customers yet. And then there's a one very good example on platform they call the Get Cruise. I'm not too sure you know those guys. That's they just acquired by the General Motors for $1 billion. But they never shipped. They don't even have full functional prototypes. So right now, there's a so-called hit rate among this so-called smart devices IoT world is a little bit different from what we perceived earlier in the VC industry, like silicon basis. So that's our point of view here. We got it.
Trying to answer your question, successful rates for the startups are bad. I mean, if we have to take in consideration the statistics, probably no one here will try to set up a startup because a statistic is saying that I'm not going to be successful. But I don't think it's the way to look at this. I mean, I think the way to look at this is that if my specific company, if I'm an entrepreneur, I'm going to set up a startup, what do we have to do in order to increase the chances to be successful? As an investor, why this specific company that I invest in am going to be successful? Because at the end, investors, they keep continuing investing in companies, and entrepreneurs, they keep setting up startups. So if we take a look to the statistics, probably they might be not a very good investment, and maybe not a very good thing to do or to start to a startup. The other thing is about what kind of things...
Common attributes of successful...
Attributes, well, I think it's a very... We need entrepreneurs with passion about what they are doing, trying to solve real problems, determination, commitment, those kind of things are, of course, those kind of things does not guarantee the success, right? But there are minimum things that you need in people in order to be able to consider a potential investment. You need to see these people passionate about what they are going to do because the journey is going to be tough. If you are successful, it's going to be tough. If you are not successful, it's going to be even tougher, right? So we need people with this kind of... And sometimes, and I have to be honest, sometimes you see entrepreneurs that they are, well, this is very cool now, be an entrepreneur, I'm going to create, set up a company. And we have to be honest with these kind of people. Maybe it's going to be cool, but it's going to be tough. I mean, someone said that being an entrepreneur is living 4 years like no one wants to live in order to be able to live the rest of your life like no other can live, right? But that's it.
Yeah, so on our side, in terms of our success track record so far, we've been investing for about 3 years. We've invested in 13 companies. 4 have been acquired at a quite nice ratio for us. In the rest, most of them have head-up rounds. One of our companies, you know, grew bookings from 1 year to the next by, you know, over 5 times. So it doesn't guarantee they'll be successful in the long run, but we're seeing a lot of really positive signs. We're fortunate. That's not natural. Normally, you know, you expect the J curve, you expect some companies to fail quickly before you see the successes. We haven't encountered a J curve yet. Doesn't mean we won't. You know, we're in a very dynamic environment. I'd say the common trait, really, for us with the startups is the quality of the entrepreneurs. You know, I mean, certainly passion, intelligence, resiliency, adaptability. You can give a really smart team a bad business plan, and normally they should be able to pivot and adapt and come up with a better approach. But you can give, you know, a B team or a C team a brilliant idea, and they'll find really interesting ways of screwing it up. So, you know, intelligence, judgment, experience, all those things come into play. And it doesn't mean it can't be a first-time entrepreneur. It doesn't mean veteran entrepreneurs will always be successful. Because sometimes people who had companies that were highly successful during bubble years don't really realize why they were successful. Sometimes they were lucky. They attribute, you know, they think they take all the credit for it, but maybe it was the environment, maybe it was something else, and you put them in a very different environment and they struggle with that. So really kind of getting to the core of the people, who they are, their experience, what they can do, their motivations also is critical.
Yeah, I can share some concrete stats on our portfolio. We've just, because we've invested in so many, like I said, 1,500 over the last 6 years. Companies that are at least, 4.5 years old, so companies from our first fund, we have had about 25% of them get an exit, so small exit. We had one that just filed for IPO, so that's like a Twilio, a very outsized return. About 20% are dead slash not operating. So actually not all companies dissolve. It takes a long time for the dissolution process sometimes. So if you're not operating for like, you know, 3-6 months, we sort of assume you're dead and we write you off. So so that's about 45% already, right? Acquired 25, dead 20. And then we have another 20 that's kind of struggling. So hasn't raised too much money, but it's still is still around, maybe trying to pivot, et cetera, make incremental changes. And then the remaining have raised significantly more funding. However, of that, I would say basically portfolio-wide, we are seeing that about the top 20% of companies is really driving 80% of the returns. So when you have a highly diversified portfolio like ours, you can really see the probabilities come through. And as for entrepreneurial attributes, I completely agree that adaptability is probably the most important. One VC, can't remember who it is, really sum it up really well, which is, the team should be really in love with solving a problem, not their own solution. So, and that's like I think that's the easiest thing to pick up after you talk to, you know, many hundreds of teams. Some teams are just in love with their solution. They're like, wouldn't it be cool if I did XYZ? They're not at all focused on the problem they're trying to solve. So just when they're talking to you about their thought process, you can sort of pick up like who is at least on the right track. And I completely agree that A teams are going to pivot their way to success. And yeah, the remainder may not have too much luck doing that. And then I really suggest all the entrepreneurs in the audience, one good article that I recently read was an interview by Josh Koppelman, who is, founding partner of First Round Capital, very successful VC. And one of the things he noted was, entrepreneurs should be really spending the bulk of their time thinking about the idea, sometimes maybe years before they go and jump in, trying to start something. And then also that when, what was the other thing? And also serial entrepreneurs actually sometimes can be less thoughtful about the next problem they're trying to solve. And I've definitely experienced this where I have, or our fund has invested in serial entrepreneurs where their first company was very successful, probably because they were very cautious, very thoughtful about what they were doing, and because they were successful, their second thing wasn't quite as, amazing because they were like, oh, I'm a big deal CEO. So, yeah, it's hard. Basically, it's hard every time, regardless of what your past track record has been.
Mm-hmm. Great. I have a follow-up question on this, but before I ask my question, we have a startup team here, local startup team, these young gentlemen here, Kevin, Peter. I will ask you to ask a question after my question, okay? I want them to know you. The follow-up question is, outside your portfolios, do you have any sense generally what's the success rate of startups is increasing or decreasing?
I think at the end, rate is a combination of how many are
right.
and how many are successful.
Right.
I think that more and more, every year we have more and more startups. I mean, this is a trend that probably is the next big thing, right? More and more startups all around the world. And I think also that people every day are much more well-educated and much more well-prepared for these kind of journeys. We have more people, like 500 startups or us, or other people helping more and more startups. But I think that if we combine also that more and more startups are coming to the ground, I think the successful rate is being in the same place. I mean, it's because all the things that are surrounding a startup are remain the same, right? It's probably we have more and more successful startups, but it's also true that we have more and more startups in mm-hmm. in the game, right? Mm-hmm.
Or I can rephrase my question: is there a bubble? Because if there is, then the success rate should be decreasing, right?
But I think the bubble is not related with the number of startups. It's related with the valuation of the startups, the amount of money that is investing in the startups. Maybe Aymeric can speak more about the potential bubble, because you have a lot of money in these companies. I don't think that there is a bubble coming. I mean, it's I think that we have learned from the past. Of course, there might be some companies that might we have discussions about valuation. Is Uber worth $60 billion or something like that? Well, we can have discussions about that. But at the end of the day, it's a small number in the middle of a huge amount of money coming out to these startups. I don't know, Amerik.
Yeah, it's more like there are micro bubbles in certain sectors that come and go. Because you know, you look at some of the valuations in the past were accused of being kind of bubblicious and kind of crazy, like Microsoft's private investment in Facebook. People are like, are you kidding? A $15 billion valuation? And now that's looking really inexpensive and a really brilliant move, right? Same thing with a bunch of other startups in the ecosystem, or even you know what Facebook paid for some of the messaging platforms they've acquired. You're like, one of the companies, like even Instagram, you're like, all right, they weren't monetizing anything, they paid a huge amount, but they were able to take that and really leverage that into something else. So that probably proved to be an inexpensive acquisition for them. So a lot of these things you can detect kind of in hindsight where things were, but it doesn't feel, I mean, I was investing in the late 90s, this doesn't feel at all like that era. You see some aspects in some sectors where the valuations kind of ran up a little bit, and those are being corrected, but it's not kind of systemic.
Yeah, we invest globally, so I'd have to agree, especially in certain geographies, they're probably, it's consistently undervalued, and in other geographies, it can be, especially in certain sectors, it can be very expensive. But just going back to your question of like, are success rates increasing or decreasing? I would think they're increasing, right? Or maybe percentage-wise, it's going to be very hard to tell, but there are definitely a lot more successful outcomes for entrepreneurs because, number one, they're just like, the macro environment's really good where you have a lot more potential customers, you have a lot more talent, you have a lot more people willing to invest in you, et cetera, right, for tech, especially internet. And then my question would be like, is it like what's considered success, right? So out of our portfolio of 1,500, right now we only have one that's filed for IPO. And it, by the way, it's like the first IPO filing in a very long time. So if you look at that, if you look at the public markets and define IPO as success, then I think everyone's failing, right? Because there are no filings even. But if you look at, you know, if you consider like is a $10 million outcome for someone working on their startup for 3 years a good metric of success? Because if it is, then I know plenty. I think there are a lot more people who can reach that level of success nowadays than before, right? And many of these people actually aren't even, they don't even need our money, right? There are pockets of the internet where you really can, make these kind of businesses work. They're not venture type returns, but I would argue it's successful for the entrepreneur. I would definitely think that would be successful.
Thank you. Thank you, Ray. We only have 4 minutes left, so Peter or Ken, and this lady here, and thank you very much for raising your hand. I apologize for not being able to give you the chance to ask, but after the session in private, you can approach the panel. Peter or Ken, go ahead. Thank you.
Okay. May I ask a question about, I have a question. As an investor, I want to know, do you care more about the maybe ability or smartness of an entrepreneur than their product idea? Because we know it's very, the future is unpredictable, and we may change our product, may pivot several times. But I guess a smart entrepreneur is have more.
So the question is, do they care more about your products or
do you care more about the ability or smartness of the entrepreneur than their
people or products?
Yeah.
Do you care more about their product or the people, the team?
Well, I think that the question is that if we see that the idea is much more important or the team. But the idea is worth nothing. The idea is worth nothing. Because the idea going to change. I mean, a lot of things are going to change. What we need is to invest in a team that is going to be able to manage or to manage this idea from this initial idea to something really relevant for the market and to try to help them. The team at the end is the most important thing because they should be the ones able to find the product fit and the market fit of this idea, initially idea. So for me, ideas, well, I wouldn't say worth nothing, but it's not the most important thing. The most important thing is the team.
Yeah, and it ties back into the product because, taking a good public example of that, if you look at Apple and the iPod and the creation of the iPod, they really had a stellar team with, the design sense of Steve Jobs, phenomenal industrial designers, Tony Fadell, phenomenal engineering team. They weren't the first MP3 player. There were lots of them out there. Rather famously, a site called Slashdot, that's kind of a big site for kind of tech news and kind of things that are related to the Computex audience. The editor of Slashdot said, what's this iPod? It's got no Wi-Fi, doesn't have a color screen, capacity's not that big. His feedback, his one-word feedback at the end of that was lame, kind of like, this thing's not going to fly. And it became a phenomenal success. I mean, because there's good team shepherding it, they created a great product, good user experience with the back end as well, with the operating system, the ability of having something like FireWire instead of USB 1.0 to transfer files really quickly, phenomenal synchronization software. That really came from the team that had a good vision and a good understanding of what would make for a compelling product. So kind of one flows from the other, basically.
Yeah, I would agree that like the product is really a manifestation of the team's intelligence or abilities. So it's different if you're just still at the idea stage. Yeah, I would argue that idea is not really worth much. But if you already have a product, then I think the abilities of the team manifests itself in why did you design the product this way, and why are you testing the product this way, and what are you learning when you are marketing or selling your product this way. And when your customer is giving you feedback, how are you able to make decisions to be better in whatever way that you need to be. So, there are some very young teams who are, pivoting their idea every day. In effect, they're not even really pivoting. They're just completely changing whatever they're doing every day. So I would say that is a very strong signal of a team that does not know what they're doing, right? So you can pivot, but the pivots should have a very strong reasoning, right? It's not just randomly throwing, let me see if this will work, and throwing random darts at the wall.
Great, thank you, Ray. And thank you for your question. Our time is up. The session's topic is the next big thing. We talk about AI, AR/VR, especially on the content side or peripheral side. We talk about biomedical, we talk about smart home, smart alliances, communication protocols, navigational system, and we also talk about decentralization system. That's a very interesting idea. We also talk about the attributes successful entrepreneur must have. We talk about passion, determination, perseverance, and adaptability, and thoughtfulness. And thank you very much for your thoughtful views, and thank you very much for your thoughtful question. It's been fun. Thank you. A round of applause for our panel.
Thank you, Lucas, Amory, and Anhel. Thank you very much.